June 5th, 1967, Israel occupied the rest of Palestine, Gaza, West Bank, including Jerusalem, for 43 days only, 43. Israel said, we are an occupying power. And accordingly, Israel obliged with international law. And that means Israel can deal only and precisely with security affairs related to the security of the Israeli army as occupying power. And they are committed to protect civilians during the occupation according to Geneva Conventions. After 43 days, Israel said, we are not occupying power. We are administrating Gaza West Bank, including East Jerusalem, and this is disputed territories. Accordingly, Israel has a free hand from their point of view to do whatever they like. Flashback, when the Second World War happened, tens of millions of Europeans has been killed. Tens of cities, of villages has been razed. Almost 85 million Europeans has been killed. The Holocaust occurred. That's why everybody said, all right, let us sit and conclude lessons. Civilians need protection at the time of war. The time of war, this happened between two armies, but the civilians should be protected. So Geneva Conventions and international law, it's there to protect civilian at the time of war, and we, the Palestinians, has nothing to do with it. It's not our invention. It's not our creature. It is the international community creature. And at the day of Nakba, when the Nakba occurred for Palestinians, and millions of Palestinians became refugees in 1948, it coincided with the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So, Universal Declaration for Human Rights, it's not also a Palestinian invention. The UNRWA, which is the United Nations Refugees Agency, which was created for the Palestinian refugees, PLO didn't exist then. So this was the decision of international community about millions of Palestinian refugees, their problem should be tackled and dealt with. Israel, 53, we are not occupying power. We can do whatever we want. Now, this is the theory. What about the practice? From 1967, immediately after the 43 days, settlements considered in law war crimes. Settlers are war criminals. They said, all right, we will do settlements and we will bring settlers in the occupied territories. You cannot annex any part of the country by law, and this is a war crime. And they said, Jerusalem, our capital, and they made decision in the Knesset to annex it. Prisoners, it's illegal to torture them. They issued a law allowing torture by law. It's the only country on earth allowing torture to be practiced in the name of the law. expulsion. They take groups of people, expelling them outside the occupied territories for whatever reason, and they feel they have absolute right to do that. They also put prisoners in administrative detention, meaning you are there for indefinite period of time and nobody can hold you accountable. Targeted assassination, for whatever reason, by Apache or by special unit, they go and make hunt. Raja Sorani, we have to get rid of him. They make a trial in absentia. They say he should die. Special unit go, boom, boom. They finish him up and no problem. All these in law called war crimes. We as people, as the whole world, as the international community, as the UN says, we are subject to occupation. We are entitled to Article 1 of the Convention of Civil Political Rights. Article 1 says any occupied people, they have the right to resist and to get rid of the occupation. That means we, the Palestinian people under the occupation, with all international support, has to act against this occupation using all means, including even the armed struggle, to get rid of this Israeli belligerent occupation. Especially we are talking about prolonged, deep criminal occupation, who are having the civilians in the eye of the storm of their policy. 47 years passed, and Palestinian people were using all ways and means of struggle, and very unfortunately, full legal and political immunity given to Israel by US, by Europe, and in the Security Council, and in the ICC, and Israel manage and act in a very free way, and they are not afraid of accountability. In 1974, Bruno Kreisky and Ulf Palma from Sweden contacted President Arafat, and they said to him, "What do you want?" He said, "Well, the Palestinian PLO convention, very simple. We are asking for one Palestinian state, secular for Muslim, Christian, and Jews in Palestine." They say, "But you have a problem with the West. What's the problem?" This is a call for destruction of Israel. If you say, "I want a Palestinian state in Gaza, West Bank, and Jerusalem," everybody can understand that, and we will support you. Entire Europe and the world. And in 1974, President Arafat made a call and he said, "We want a Palestinian state next to Israel in Gaza, West Bank, including Jerusalem." But what had happened? That Ulf Palma soon assassinated, and the entire thing went out, and nobody really paid a care for this historical compromise by Palestinians when 80% of Palestine, historical Palestine, has been compromised. In 1993, 1993, Arafat concluded Oslo Accords with Rabin. But soon Rabin was assassinated. He wasn't assassinated by a Palestinian. And it was supposed 5 years transitional period, and Palestinian people should be entitled to self-determination independence. We are right now 20 years after Oslo Accords. What we are having and what the reality in Palestine. First, anyone talk about peace, this is illusion in mind. It has nothing to do with the reality. This is something you can read it in a newspaper, but on the skin of the people, there is the death, the destruction, the siege, the suffocation, socially, economically. There is the land confiscation and all kinds of crimes. Peace, nobody in the occupied territory is talking about it. It's vice versa. Everybody in the occupied territories think how to make war, because the situation, it's not tolerable at all. And to specify more about the situation, I'll begin with Gaza, where we are in very deep suffering, unprecedented. I'm 60. But in a nightmare, if you ask me, when Oslo Accords were signed, you will come to this situation. And I was opposing, as some of you here know it very well, Oslo Accords. I want to dream that we will come to 1/50th of the situation that we are suffering right now. I mean with that, in Gaza, they imposed this siege after clear democratic elections we made where Hamas won. And they claim because of it's Hamas. But Arafat was before. And he's the one who signed Oslo. And they dealt with him as terrorist, and he ended up being killed by them after prolonged siege that has been imposed on him. And after humiliating him in unprecedented way and devil. After the Oslo Accords, things began to deteriorate more and more, and this siege, it dried up the life of the people. I mean, nobody can go in or out from Gaza by land, by air, or by sea. On the sea, max people can use 3 nautical kilometers only, and on land, without Israeli approval, nobody can go in or out, neither individuals or goods. And on air, we used to have airport in Gaza, and the entire airport has been destroyed and become like an agricultural field. No one can use it anymore, though it has been built by a very Western money. A friend of mine has his daughter sick in leukemia. He was fighting almost for 2.5 years just to get her out of Gaza, and that's rather mission impossible for him to do that. She was dying in the front of his eyes. The level of unemployment, it's almost 65%, not because the people are lazy and unable to work, but because Israel don't allow goods to come in or to go out. We cannot import, we cannot export, we cannot do any activities because one bag of cement is not allowed without the Israeli approval. And that's why this percent of unemployment is very high, almost 90% unable they are in poverty line, and 85% in dependence totally on UNRWA, World Food Program, and others. So the siege, the embargo, really suffocating the life of people by all meanings, by all standards. Two wars happened in the last 7 years, and it wasn't allowed to rebuild, to reconstruct. Buildings has been destroyed, I mean with that, houses, universities, etc. Even hospitals has been bombarded, and some of them needed intervention by governments in order to be fixed, like the Red Crescent Hospital and so on. Anyway, this occupation with his policy of siege embargo, which is supported by the Americans and European countries, it suffocated Gaza socially and economy. It is, in simple words, the biggest human-made disaster in the 21st century. We are not in defense of Hamas. We are not in defense of Fatah or PFLP, but simply we are in defense of civilians. That's why human rights organizations do exist, to defend civilians at the time of war, not peace. And at the time of war, they are the most vulnerable target for the Israeli occupation. In the two wars, I'll give some just a quick short notice about some of the Israeli practice before, during, and after. One, it's a Daraj case. F-16 fighter, jet fighter, up in the sky, 5 after 12 midnight, they drop a bomb, 985 kilos, targeting one of Hamas leaders. But away from the leaders, this is the most dense populated area in Gaza, and Gaza already one of the most dense populated areas on earth. This bomb, when they dropped it, tens of houses has been destroyed. 16 people in the spot died, mainly women and children, and almost 238 have lifetime injuries. I mean, their hands, legs, or kidneys, or eyes amputated. This is just in one case. They target a Dalo family. And Dalo family, you know, another F-16 drop a bomb, and within seconds, 20 people has been raised, and only lived the father, who accidentally was outside bringing some food back to the home. Huda Ghalia was on the beach with her family, 6 of them within seconds, 3 gunboats hit them, and the 6 were killed, and she was left alone when she was 12 years old. Of course, I mean, these are non-stop stories. This is every day, today, story you can tell and you can hear about. All in all, this criminal siege, many tried to challenge it. We tried. Israeli human rights tried, international human rights organization tried, and the creme de la creme of the world civil society tried to come and break this siege, tried to break the embargo. Irish, Spanish, from the PASC, from France, from England, from Turkey, and many of them really were their life in danger, and many of them has been arrested, many has been harassed, many has been tortured, many has been interrogated, and many, up to nine, has been killed while they are trying this attempt. Yet, Gaza under siege, and we are having the biggest human-made disaster ever in history. On the other side, we are having Jerusalem, where Jerusalem reads subject to ethnic cleansing for Palestinians, Christians or Muslims, and who are there. I mean, attempts on the administrative, legal, practical level to Judaization of Jerusalem. And Israel imposed fait accompli policy where the situation almost irreversible with the new facts they are imposing. And you can say there is above the city something and under the city something else. And Jerusalem now really in very critical condition. Not only that, but we, the Palestinians, entirely are not allowed to go and visit it. Even to pray in it, we are not allowed. West Bank, in simple words, we are talking about a new brand of apartheid. We can say, yes, maybe Israel angry of Hamas and the siege on Gaza, it has reason. The Gazans were stupid. They elected Hamas. Why they elect Hamas? They should be punished. So let them suffer. But they have, as they say, the fantastic partner, our president in Ramallah. And they talked to him nicely, and they said he is better than Arafat. Arafat was real. Bloody terrorist, Abu Mazen, fantastic, and he's cooperating. But with Abu Mazen, 500 checkpoints all over the West Bank, making movement between villages, camps, cities, rather mission impossible. And you would be shocked, I mean, about the difficulties, how it's mission impossible for people in Hebron or Bethlehem to go to the north of the West Bank, Ramallah, Nablus, and Jenin, and other places. It's not a checkpoint, I mean, where you pass, show your ID card, and play. No, it's sort of big, huge, institutionalized, and you need, I mean, you know, checking for hours. Sometimes you stay 5, 6, 7, 8 hours. Sometimes you can pass, sometimes, some other times you cannot. Two, every day, incursions for villages, camps, and cities. There is Palestinian police, there is security, cooperation between Palestinians and the Israelis, but they trust nobody. And they keep encouraging. While they are encouraging with the army, with the police, shooting, killing, etc., happens, and many arrests. It's not only that, but the settlements, as I explained before, it's a war crime. You cannot. You have no right to do it. It's ongoing war crime. There was not a single settlers, I mean, 67. Now in Jerusalem, they exceeded more than the Palestinians in number in East Jerusalem. And in the West Bank, we are talking almost about 600,000 Israelis who are in the Israeli settlement. So we are talking about the occupied territories already. There is almost more than 1 million people exist in the West Bank. Israelis supported, funded, protected entirely by this belligerent occupation. Israel didn't satisfy with that. They connected these settlements, some of them with trains, some of them with metros, and all that with bypass roads, especially designated for settlers between the Israeli settlements and the Israeli cities. So they are connected very well. While they are suffocating us, chopping us parts and pieces, separating Gaza from the West Bank, separating Jerusalem from the West Bank, separating north from the south of the West Bank, they are connecting settlements with Israel in a very solid way with a special road. Palestinians are not allowed even to use it. We have 5,000 Palestinian prisoners. They are freedom fighters, surely. They are fighting for their people, for their cause. And they are dealing with them like sub-criminals. I mean, till this date, we are calling for Palestinian prisoners' right to be close to the Israeli criminals inside the prison. And we still very far from the Israeli criminals even to reach that. We are the worst category, I mean, among prisoners. And as I said, Israel, the only country on earth, legitimized torture and maltreatment against, I mean, Palestinian prisoners during their period of interrogation. For me, first time I was arrested, I was thinking I'm a smart lawyer, good lawyer, I understand everything. And I was then a little bit in politics. When I used to visit, I mean, the prison, I see Chavi. How are you, Chavi? He looks nice. I mean, his eyes still, I mean, you know, there. And he has no deep cuts. And he has no bruises. And I would say, have you been tortured? Of course not. And because for me, torture meant physical marks on the body, bruises, something, I mean, you can see. When I was imprisoned, there is legal terminology called moderate physical and psychological pressure on prisoners. If they use this moderate physical and psychological pressure, and they have the top notches of psychologists, of doctors, who control torture and give the guidelines for the Secret Service. I personally, I'm not talking about any other body experience, went through that in the first time 87 days, 87. And every time they just leave me when I lose my conscious. In the 87 days, every day, you wish to die 100 times, 100 times. And you see children there, it's not adults, from 12 years old on, having the same treatment like us. And this is legal in Israel, and you go to the Israeli High Court of Justice, and the Israeli High Court of Justice, which is providing legal cover for all these crimes, say, of course torture is bad, but we have to do it. Because they are too much criminals. People who struggle for their self-determination, they are too much criminals. They deserve that. So torture is going on. You are in the prison, you are sick. You need to be operated. I mean, this is health, very health-oriented thing. But they will keep you in line 2, 3, 5, 7 years till you are really in a bad situation and you might die, or at least you suffer, at least if you don't die, but we'll leave you, you know, as such. Some of the families didn't visit their dears. I mean, sons or daughters or father or mother or a brother or sister for 7, 8, and 9 years. So it's not only torture for the prisoner, it's torture for the family, away from the fact that the prisoners inside Israel is by itself violation of law. They should be kept near the cities they are living at according to international humanitarian law. Targeted assassination, this is the very day-to-day practice. We don't like Muhammad. We don't like Ali. They behave like civilians, but in a minute they can change, and Muhammad can take the telephone, instruct others to do bombing or killing, whatever. That we concluded we have to kill him. A trial in absentia. They make judgment on people in death penalty. This doesn't happen in Ouagadougou, you know? And the Apache and the drones up on the sky, boom, boom, and finished. The problem, most of the assassinations doesn't kill individuals. With those individuals, which, I mean, this is a crime against them, many Palestinian has been killed. I mean, in each assassination, you will find minimal 7, 8, 9, 10 people, you know, civilians has been killed. So you are talking about hundreds of civilians has been killed during this attempt. And always they try to inflict pain and terror in the hearts and lives of people. The practices in the West Bank was appalling. And some of our South African friends, comrades who came, you know, to visit us in the occupied territories, they were saying, we were having very bad and tough apartheid system in South Africa, but it's not so ugly. It's not so bloody. It's not so rude and obvious, you know, as what's happening there. This is unbelievable. Even our South African counterparts, they think this a new brand of apartheid unprecedented. Why I spoke about Olof Palme and Bruno Kreisky in 74. We the Palestinians want one state solution, a two-state solution, one state solution in the very beginning. And then when Olof Palme and the Kreisky asked for two-state solution, we said, fine, I mean, let us have two-state solution. This two-state solution, when it was signed, it led us to this. Gaza suffocated, socially and economically under embargo, Jerusalem ethnic cleansing for Palestinians, and the West Bank a new brand of apartheid. We cannot accept that. And we have no right to be good victims for criminals, for belligerent occupation. And we have to fight, I mean, for our rights. But the Israeli governments doing the following. They are in need, and they declare, we want the purity of the Jewish state. We want a pure Jewish state. But they cannot accept, annex settlements, land, and the people, they don't want. Now the policies of settlements, of checkpoints, of annexation, of the practices in Jerusalem, making the two-state solution rather mission impossible. Nobody, I mean, can imagine if this will continue in a few years that two-state solution is any possible, I mean, to be achieved or to have a Palestinian state, but rather one state solution. But they want to take all Palestine without Palestinians. This cannot happen. We, in simple words, the stones of the valley. have been there ever. We have been there long. And no power on earth can take us from there. We know colonials, occupiers, as you know here exactly, cannot stay for good. They will leave one day. In 1 year, fine. In 10 years, fine. 20 years, fine. 50 years, fine. Because we are tomorrow, and they will be yesterday. No colonial, no occupier on earth, including Israel, can continue for good. That's our strength. Facts are so rude, so tough, so bloody. It doesn't take from us any level of hope. We are full of strategic optimism. We, like you, defending just, fair, right cause. And we know that tomorrow is ours, and the most beautiful day didn't come yet, and it will come, hopefully. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Raji. Bueno, tenemos bastante tiempo. A Raji le gusta hacer una presentación y después interactuar bastante con los y las asistentes, así que tenéis oportunidad de preguntarle sobre cualquier cuestión que os parezca de interés. Hay un micrófono, o sea que la persona que quiera hablar que lo solicite.
It's quite impressive to hear from you about the criminal policy of Israel, which is quite well known by the international nation. But one of the main support for Israel has been historically the USA, especially the US lobby. And at the beginning of the Obama administration, it was a kind of hope that it will change the American policy. I don't know if you keep any hope with this change, or you just don't think that anything is going to change from the American policy. Because obviously, the way that they can keep this criminal policy is because basically because the USA and obviously also Europe is supporting this policy, otherwise it will be impossible to keep. So I don't know if you keep any hope that it will change in this American administration.
Let me put it this way. I mean, this is very important, and thank you, I mean, because you ask it and you want to highlight this, really. The Americans know the realities, and they know what's going on. They know exactly what's going on the ground. I personally received the most important and the most prestigious human rights award in the U.S. That's the RF Kennedy Award for Human Rights. I'm blacklisted. I'm a criminal. I cannot go to U.S. I don't know, I mean, how these Americans thinking. I'm blacklisted. I'm not allowed to reach, I mean, U.S. But a few years ago, there was some hope. Friend of mine, American lawyer, I know him for years and years, 25 years almost, was appointed as a human rights officer at the State Department. And I thought, oh, hallelujah. I mean, you know, this man will get me to the United States. I'm a lawyer, human rights activist. You know me. Well, Michael, what do you think about this and that? A friend, joint friend told him. He said, little bit difficult. And after 3 years of work, he said, we can get him 1 week on waiver. You remember when Mandela went to US? He was blacklisted. And they allowed him first time to go to US on waiver. So if people like us terrorists, who US will respect? When Obama, the learned lawyer, the fantastic lawyer, was elected, he gave two speeches. One in Berlin, and it's piece of legal human rights art. Believe me, I said, oh my God, this is our new prophet. I mean, American president, I mean, talking this way, all right. I mean, let us trust at least what he's saying, and let us be open. And he gave his speech in Cairo, and he spoke about Palestine. He spoke about human dignity, about self-determination, right of people. And I think he's a liar, and he has no respect for basic fundamental values. This is not personal. This is a judgment. Take, for example, two things. We go and use universal jurisdiction to bring accountable Israeli war criminals, like we did in UK, with Doron Elmog, it's a Belivni, and like we did in Madrid, in Audiencia Nacional, with Benjamin Belaizer, Avi Dichter, and some others. They pressure these governments to change the law. They pressure them. You have to fix it to bring immunity for it. We have Goldstone report, and Goldstone didn't say anything new, nothing new. The facts are there, it has been stated by everybody. And what's unique at Goldstone, two things. Time frame, he said 6 months. If Israel doesn't hold accountable criminals, then UN Security Council should refer it to the ICC. And they say, no Security Council, I'll use the veto. Boom, nothing. So Goldstone report, which talk about law, and Goldstone himself, he's a Jew. No Goldstone report, no accountability. So you are doing crimes and you are in amnesty. Three, we were given the recognition on 29th of November 2012 to be non-member state in the UN. That means we can sign, ratify ICC Rome Statute. And that means, not PLO, we, as lawyers, as representatives of victims, can make click, and hundreds of cases go to the ICC, and they can be held accountable. They said to President Abbas, no way to go sign and ratify the ICC. You are not allowed, even to UNESCO. This had happened, but this will not be repetitive. And if you think of doing that, PA will be dried up. So my judgment, not from the political value, but from the legal value, for a president who is a lawyer and respected lawyer and professional lawyer, he knows what international law, what's international material law. I'm not talking about Bush, the alcoholic. No, I'm talking about Obama. Obama says, no. Now, why you hate Bin Laden? why the Americans and the Europeans hate bin Laden. Because you have to choose between rule of law and rule of jungle. And bin Laden used rule of jungle. But you are very stereotyped bin Laden. I mean, you are just repeating what bin Laden is doing. Bin Laden did it once, and you changed the whole world in rule of law, in human rights. There is no holy, unholy blood. There is no holy, unholy suffering. There is no holy and unholy soil. All human beings are equal. I don't think after 1.5 period of Obama time, anything really can change in the position of U.S. administration. It's obvious the institutions controlling everything. I would love to see change, but we shouldn't buy the illusions. That doesn't mean we have to stop fight. There is one change in the U.S., and I'm telling you very clearly. The change, it's within young and social movement and academia. There is clear indicators that there is a change. There is a frustration, non-acceptance. And with the week I was granted to go on waiver, I was shocked, because when I used to lecture at Harvard University or at Columbia University or at Washington or Georgetown, I used to have very, very aggressive position and attitude, either from the students or the academic. Last time I was there, I was shocked. Because usually when they criticize, they just bring the best of me, and they provocate me. And we have a lot to say usually. But this time, really, it was fantastic environment, very positive response. People understand and people support, and seldom shy criticism, I would say. So just to make this brief, on the level of the presidential cabinet, I don't think there is any change or any illusion. On the level of the institutions, I think it remains as it is. We still having some hope in the future, and we have no right to give up and keep working there. U.S. keep important and very important dimension.
Señor Sorani, después de muchos años de trabajo como abogado y también después de muchos años de vida como palestino, ¿cuál es la conclusión final que usted puede extraer acerca del proyecto estratégico del Estado sionista? ¿Cuál es el objetivo final del Estado sionista? ¿Qué es lo que quiere realmente? ¿Es verdad la propaganda de que los judíos que no tenían tierra, que sencillamente querían un sitio donde vivir? En los años 40 y 50, toda esta propaganda, a la hora de reflexionar acerca de las políticas reales del Estado de Israel desde los años 40 hasta ahora, Como defensor de los derechos humanos y como palestino, ¿a qué conclusión puede llegar usted? Gracias.
I have to say two things. The first, when the Holocaust happened in Europe, the Jews fled to different places, and part of them, major part, came to our country seeking the safe haven. And everybody, I mean, received them nicely, warmly. And we thought at the time, as my grandpa and others say, received these people as victims, and your people hugged them, accepted them. And Palestine has history of tolerance and accepting the others, except we think God is stupid when he brought the three major religions, I mean, to that small part of the world. There is real culture of tolerance, accepting the other, coexistence and cooperation. And that's why when they came, I mean, most welcome, ahlan wa sahlan, and they lived like us, like part of us. I mean, and we didn't have any sensitivity. But we came the victim of the victim, very unfortunately. We were rewarded by what they are doing. We are paying the price Europe was supposed to pay. We are the one who delivered for generations. And now Europe do support them in their crimes. This is the worst. A victim escaped, come to safe haven, come to our country, welcome, hug, ahlan wa sahlan, no problem. And then he become the victimizer for those who received him. And much worse, the original who did the crime against them are supporting them in doing this. C'est unfair, as the French say. It's totally unfair and unhuman. From day one, it doesn't need, I mean, smart, super smart people, I mean, to think and reflect about. This is one side. On the other side, leave all politics. Israel, the oasis of democracy in the Middle East. The oasis of democracy. Those bloody Arabs, ignorant, stupid, no values, nothing. Okay. We want to make judgment on rule of law and the human rights. These are simple standards. You have law, means the standard. You have facts, you have conclusion. If Israel, real civilized and law country, why they are so worried from the ICC? Why they are worried? Let them get the Palestinians, I mean, to the ICC. We are the criminals, no? We are the terrorists. Why Israel doesn't take us there? Universal jurisdiction. We are trying to bring Israeli criminals. If we, the Palestinian leaders, are criminals, why don't you use it? They are very smart and they have fantastic lawyers too. Give me one organization on earth, professional, independent, credible, doesn't say Israel do war crimes and Israeli leaders are war criminals. With the standards, with facts, and simple conclusions. It's the arrogance of power. You know, I always describe occupation like quicksands. And every move you do, simply you sink more. And the worst, it's the moral sinking. Israel state with no morals. And the problem, they are not recognizing they are doing war crimes. This is the most dangerous thing. They are not recognizing and they are not. You know what they say about our work? I'm the one who defend Samouni, Daya, Huda Ghalia, and thousands and thousands of Palestinian victims, civilian victims. We are doing law fair. We are doing legal war. Why? Because we are the agents of the terrorist organizations, and we are misusing law, international law, and the human rights. You inflict pain on them because by using international law, international humanitarian law, and these specific standards, you make them look ugly. So, if you ask me about where this state will go, well, in history, you can find the states existed and vanished. Easy. If you are not based and well founded on ethics, on standards, on values, in history, in right doing, in positive contribution, on being part of the humanity family, it's very hard, I mean, you know, to continue as such. I think they are committing, whether they are aware or not, first class suicide, politically wise and ethically wise.
Bueno, galdera xume bat. Zer egin dezakegu guk, hiritarrok? Barkatu. Zer dakagu guk egitea, herritarrok? Nola lagundu?
First, you are doing already. I mean, the fact you are seeking, knowing the truth, you are coming to listen, that for me means a lot. And to come on Friday evening, I mean, instead of enjoying, I mean, your weekend and devoting this time, this is very meaningful to me. Second, we have fantastic relation with the PASC political and civil society movement, and here and many of the friends, colleagues and comrades, I mean, came to Palestine and visited us there, not in a formal solidarity. We know, I mean, how the heart and the mind work and how real, I mean, they are. Three, I think it's very important to break the conspiracy of silence. You said it rightly and absolutely right. A little, I mean, known about this in public domain. And we have really to break the conspiracy of silence by, I mean, with that, restating the facts and make people, you know, aware about what's going on there. Israel has real good control on a lot of media, but we, as they have this government coordination and cooperation, we have more fantastic coordination and cooperation. We have the grassroots movement across the globe who are in support and solidarity with the cause of Palestine. And I feel proud, believe me, when I go to Tokyo and find your solidarity with the Palestinian people, when I go to Stockholm and I find solidarity, when I go to South Africa, this became like the ethical standard of the struggle, I mean, universally wise. Are you with them or against them? I mean, just as simple as that. Because I think it's beyond Palestine. It went beyond. It's not, if some here old enough and can understand what I mean, it's like the Vietnam time, you know. Are you with them or with the Americans, you know, which means, are you with the free or with the suppressors and oppressors? I mean, this is one of the standards. Now, practically speaking, I think El Paz can bring the fourth dimension. I mean, it's very, very important. I mean, ethically, morally, and politically, and humanly. I mean, having clear support from this part of the world. Yeah, for example, sorry, we are talking about Europe and what Europe can do, what European, away from the BDS campaign, for example. I don't know why, yani I'm asking sometimes some European foreign ministers, and so they say, Israel doing bad, but you know, I mean, but we cannot really do much. I ask them, you cannot activate Article 2 of the Association Agreement. Article 2, which make Israel send 70% of their exports to Europe, and they have the privileges. Don't sanction Israel, but don't give it privileges. These are privileges. They are tax exempted. You want to keep association agreement, fine. Can any European ask me why you are rewarding Israel by being part of the Eurovision? Why Israel part of the European Eurovision? Is it because it's a fantastic country? Why Israel part of youth cooperation? And every year, tens of thousands of Europeans go to camps in Israel funded by Europe to be educated about the democracy of Israel and the oasis of democracy. Why Israel part of the scientific cooperation with Europe? I don't know. And I cannot understand why Israel, I mean, there is tens of items, it's just making, you know, even the space science and informations are exchanged with Israel. I don't know why. Why Israel being treated as first-class European country as a state above law? Now, if you don't want to sanction, if you don't want to make BDS, if you don't want to activate Article 2 of the Association Agreement, at least stop giving Israel these fantastic added values. But very unfortunately, Europe is doing that.
Solamente una aclaración a lo que ha comentado Raji. La campaña BDS a la que hace referencia Raji es la campaña de boicot, desinversiones y sanciones, que es una campaña tomada en parte del boicot que se le hizo a la Sudáfrica de la apartheid, basada en esa idea. Es una campaña que se lanza por la sociedad civil palestina en el año 2005, la cual apoyan a día de hoy más de 400 organizaciones civiles, sindicatos y partidos políticos palestinos, y es un llamamiento a la población de los países de todo el mundo a no participar activamente en la colonización, en la ocupación de Palestina. Las tres siglas de la campaña BDS son boicot, desinversiones y sanciones. Para explicarlo muy brevemente, el primer nivel sería el boicot, que se puede ejercer a varios niveles, a nivel comercial, a nivel deportivo, a nivel cultural, a nivel académico, que supone una decisión personal de cada uno y cada una de nosotros, que es si yo quiero participar de la ocupación de Palestina, comprando en este caso un producto israelí, muchos de los cuales además están sacados, expropiados y robados de la propia, del propio territorio palestino ocupado, ¿no? Como pueden ser los jabones del Mar Muerto, como puede ser el agua que exporta Israel, como puede ser un montón de productos, de bienes, ¿no?, de consumo. También podemos decidir si acudir o no a un espectáculo cultural que venga subvencionado, por ejemplo, por el Ministerio de Cultura israelí, el cual gasta al año millones y millones de euros para normalizar esa imagen de Israel por todo el mundo, ofreciendo esa cara más amable del Estado de Israel como una sociedad moderna, como una sociedad muy cerca a la occidental o parte de la sociedad occidental y demás. Como ha comentado Raji, seguimos sin entender por qué los equipos israelíes, que nos visitan además aquí en Euskal Herria todos los años, juegan al baloncesto en las ligas europeas. Pues también hay un llamamiento, por supuesto, a no fomentar, ¿no?, esa participación tanto de cantantes, de equipos deportivos. La parte dedicada a las desinversiones iría más enfocada a las empresas, tanto locales, estatales y demás, que de alguna forma invierten en Israel o en compañías que se lucran mediante la ocupación de Palestina. Ahí pues está trabajando con diferentes empresas, aquí en Guipúzcoa, en Euskal Herria, en los demás sitios, para intentar que esas empresas no participen activamente de la ocupación de Palestina, bajo la amenaza de que si siguen infringiendo el derecho internacional y si siguen apoyando esa violación de derechos humanos, pues se procederá a una serie de sanciones. Y ya el último, las sanciones, le tocaría un poco más al plano ya más político, más de los gobiernos, tanto locales y estatales, que son los que, como ya ha comentado Raji durante la charla, son realmente los que están apoyando de facto en la ocupación y la masacre en Palestina. A estos gobiernos, tanto a los gobiernos locales como a los gobiernos estatales, todos los grupos de solidaridad con el pueblo palestino, pues se les pide, para empezar, pues que primero que se acaben esos acuerdos preferenciales que tiene, por ejemplo, todos los estados europeos, Estados Unidos y las demás potencias occidentales, que se les niegue ese acceso a todas esas relaciones, esos acuerdos preferenciales de relaciones económicas, de relaciones académicas, de relaciones de investigación, etcétera, y que esas sanciones se hagan efectivas simplemente hasta que Israel cumpla con el derecho internacional y cumpla con los tratados de derechos humanos. Simplemente quería aclarar la campaña.
Una pregunta o una observación que quiero hacer es sobre el tema precisamente de hasta qué punto los tribunales internacionales no están interviniendo como debían de intervenir o hacer que se aplique la ley en Palestina. Me refiero precisamente al muro. Un muro de separación de más de 600 kilómetros. Sin embargo, aquí nos agobiaron, yo soy bastante mayorcito, y nos agobiaron precisamente con el muro de Berlín, de 3 metros de 45 por alto, más 40 y tantos kilómetros de alto. Ahora tenemos un muro de 8 metros por el proyecto total, que va a ser 1.200 kilómetros, porque baja de Jericó hasta Jerusalén, y resulta que hay en este no somos capaces de tumbar ese muro. Entonces me pregunto yo si no estamos llegando o nuestra democracia empieza a debilitarse a nivel mundial, porque hay diferentes proyectos que se están realizando y tenemos una línea en la que nos permiten además hablar hasta cierto punto o actuar hasta cierto punto, y cuando ya llegamos a la línea roja, a la línea esta en la que tocamos precisamente lo que yo considero por lo menos un proyecto de dictadura a nivel global, el que participa precisamente Estados Unidos e Israel. Porque no es de recibo ver el silencio de todos los analistas políticos occidentales, o la mayoría de ellos, que hablan precisamente de la gran revolución árabe, la caída de Morsi, lo que está pasando ahora mismo en Oriente Medio con Siria, con Líbano, y todo esto no es más que un proyecto colonialista, de alguna manera encubierto. ¿Y cómo queda Palestina en todo esto? Si estamos viendo que Palestina está quedándose, con todas estas noticias, estamos viendo que Palestina se queda otra vez, vuelve a estar otra vez al margen, mientras que las colonias siguen produciéndose como se están construyéndose. Nada más. O sea, quiero decir que estamos llegando a una dictadura a nivel global, en definitiva. No creemos que está pasando todo esto, porque no es recibo ver a una Palestina agobiada, asediada, masacrada, y aquí nadie dice nada. Los tribunales ni los gobiernos. Estamos hablando de gobiernos que reclaman derechos humanos. Es que me quedo muy mal, me quedo muy minimizado, me quedo que no soy casi humano, porque no llego a entender semejante barbaridad en un lugar tan céntrico, además de diferentes eras, ¿no?, sociales y políticas, no sé. Me preocupa mucho los tribunales internacionales, me preocupa mucho el mundo, precisamente, porque todo parece que al final acaba en Palestina. Si nos fijamos un poco, cuando empezamos a hablar de política de un sitio o de otro, aparece Palestina por un sitio, aparece Palestina por otro. No sé. Me gustaría que me aclararas un poco si no estamos llegando a esa línea roja o estamos dentro, al revés, yendo hacia atrás, hacia las nuevas dictaduras, o qué es lo que está pasando. O sea, no lo entiendo.
I appreciate very much what you said regarding the war, and this year it's the 15th anniversary regarding the advisory opinion of the ICJ, International Court of Justice. Its advisory opinion said, yes, the war is a war crime, and this war should be abolished. And it's one of the rare things, I mean, you know, that the ICJ gave its advisory opinion with complete consensus. 14 plus one who just made an argument to strengthen the 14 opinion. And I can say, as a jurist, as a lawyer, this is piece of illegal art. Has been introduced and expressed by this court, and I advise politicians who are interested in the Palestinian-Israeli conflict just to go and try to read this. The second thing that whether we really do feel alone, abandoned, and there is one dictatorship in the world applies, I mean, things as it is. No, I can assure you, Palestinian people are strong and strong enough to confront the Israelis. And I don't want to repeat it again. We feel very powerful because we have no right to be good victims, and because we know that we are defending just, fair, and right cause. And we are feeling much, much more stronger with the support we are having across the globe. You cannot think or imagine how much strong we feel when we see people from the Basque, from Ireland, from France, from Japan, US, South Africa, coming across the globe, I mean, in solidarity, in support, the way they can, I mean, you know, do it. And we are aware about their activities across the globe. Among other things, I mean, there is this BDS campaign, which is going on across the globe in a fantastic way. I was in Madrid, and I was having a meeting with a group of lawyers who are from different countries, and they are, be sure, first-class lawyers wonderful, real, committed on the ethical level, on the professional level, on the political level. And they want to make difference and they want to make a change and they contribute of their time, effort, expertise to this cause. And this group of lawyers, I mean, work just thinking around the clock, how to bring Israeli war criminals to justice. I mean with that, we feel strong. We are not abandoned. We don't feel we are abandoned and left alone. We don't think, I mean, the world closing their heart and mind and they don't want to know what's going on there. I think there is genuine interest in that and we receive very genuine support morally, physically, and otherwise. And I think you are right in one thing. I mean, if there is no real political and legal immunity provided by U.S. and if there is no conspiracy of silence, at least, provided by Europe, things can be very easy to tackle with Israel. I don't think that will be much to worry about. Now, you shifted to other area, the situation, the Arab world, and what's going on there. And I use my other hat now from Palestine, but I'll talk as a president of the Arab Organization for Human Rights in 22 Arab countries. And we have very day-to-day work, very special focus on the situation in the Arab world, in Syria, in Yemen, in other places as well. Now, to begin with, the revolution there, it was absolutely right, just, fair, and the people who made it first-class revolutionary people. The slogans of the Arab organizations for human rights, which was set 30 years ago by the creme de la creme of the Arab intellectuals and Arab human rights activist, and it was the slogans of this revolution: rule of law, democracy, human rights, and man dignity. And of course, till last minute in Tunisia, the French foreign minister suggested to Ben Ali to send and to rend expertise how to suppress the revolution there. And U.S. used to give him as the model of the new government in the region. And they didn't recognize this till Ben Ali failed and he was kicked out. In Egypt, almost after things were ruled out, the Americans supported that. But if you look to Libya and how they dealt with, it's amazing. I was in a mission to Libya, a fact-finding mission after the revolution succeeded. But I can tell you, I mean, the blueprint was very ugly and how this was misused, manipulated, you know, by the West to pay very high well. And I'm telling you now, in Libya, they are trying to chop it up to 3 to 5 pieces in order to make real control, I mean, on the situation there. I mean, the Americans, precisely, and very oil-oriented. If you are talking about Syria, it's a disaster what had happened there. Of course, I mean, we are talking about rotten dictatorship in Syria, ugly regime, and there was real revolution. But soon after that, it was taken over. I mean, because these are very genuine interests. We shouldn't think that the West, you know, especially U.S., would sit, you know, and watch what's going on there. And they see their
long time allies are dropping one after another. Why nobody say a word about Saudi Arabia as if it's the creme de la creme of human rights guardians in the world? Why nobody talk about Qatar? And it's vice versa. These rotten regimes who are defending democracy, rule of law, human rights in Syria, Egypt, and other places, and they intervene very actively by dumping billions of dollars besides arms to these countries. Our area, it's not easy. Many has real serious strategic interest in it, and they want to confuse everything at that part of the world, and they want to make the situation as bad as such. And I want to remind you, as nobody has interest after the Palestinian elections in 2006, this rosy, fantastic picture about Palestinian who can make democracy even under the occupation, the image of the good Arab, it's not allowed to be there. But I'm telling you in a brief words, because this is something I can talk for hours in it. And to conclude simply about that, there is very legitimate reasons for these revolutions. The slogans it has, very real and genuine. It wasn't directed except by real romantic revolutionary Arab people, but revolutions always, and watch my lips, read my lips, can be derailed, can go backward, can go forward, can be kidnapped, and can be killed. There is no guarantee you make revolution one stroke. We finished from Ben Ali, tomorrow everything rosy and promising. No. Revolution is very incremental, long process. It only achieves its goals when it is institutionalized, not before. And in the Arab world, I'm telling you, still a lot of fight going on, a lot of struggle going on, but people are so determined, I mean, to go with the agenda of rule of law, democracy, and the human rights.
Bueno, primero me gustaría decirle que me ha gustado mucho todo lo que ha dicho y que me parece muy especial que alguien con tanta experiencia como usted pueda contarnos todas estas cosas. Y para empezar, me gustaría plantearle dos cuestiones. La primera, que ¿qué cree usted que sería necesario para nuestros políticos y personas con poder de decisión que ocurriera para realmente tomar conciencia de cambio y para que realmente hicieran algo y tomaran cartas en el asunto y se pudiera cambiar esta situación? Y en lo que respecta al marco legal, ¿qué debería crearse o qué debería utilizarse como leyes o cortes o incluso grupos de jueces o abogados para poder cambiar esta terrible situación que hay hoy en día? Y incluso la gente de Palestina o incluso israelíes que no estén de acuerdo con lo que está ocurriendo en el ámbito legal, ¿qué podrían hacer para realmente tener opción a cambio y tener opción a mejora?
Agian galdera guztia jarraia egiten bali baditugu gola azkarro gokongo gea. Orduan, si hacemos las preguntas igual enseguido, y así tiene un grupo de preguntas y va respondiendo, ¿os parece? Orduan, hortzion bat eta hor beste bat,
Sí, yo es un poco, más que una pregunta, es también una reflexión, ¿no? Yo creo que muchas veces cuando tenemos una presencia internacional y muy importante, que nos viene a explicar la situación de otra zona del mundo, parece que siempre preguntamos qué pueden hacer los políticos, qué pueden hacer la Corte Internacional y qué puede hacer no sé qué, ¿no? O sea, eso está muy bien, pero claro, todas esas cosas, y yo creo que en la historia de este pueblo se ha demostrado, se mueven en base a lo que también hacemos nosotros. Entonces, yo creo que se había explicado bien la campaña BDS, pero se ha pasado así un poquito por encima. Y hay una cosa muy importante que podemos hacer, que es entender primero que Palestina es ahora mismo el mayor campo de concentración del mundo, el mayor, ¿eh? O sea, no es una cuestión así que nos expliquen los checkpoints, no sé qué, no sé cuál, o sea, es una falta de libertad continua, constante, todos los días, bombardean cuando quieren, matan a mucha gente, y entonces eso lo que nosotros lo que podemos hacer es implicarnos en el tema de, por lo menos intentar conocer. Hay cantidad de cosas en YouTube, en mil sitios donde podemos ver películas, reportajes, documentales, cosas grabadas allí, etcétera, etcétera, para sensibilizarnos sobre la situación de Palestina. Luego lo que podemos hacer es socializarlo. O sea, es decir, nosotros podemos ser agentes activos en la solidaridad con Palestina, pero podemos ser organizando cosas, porque hay movimientos en los que organizarnos, y si no, participando en lo que se organice. Claro, para eso tenemos que eliminar también algunas veces las cosas que creemos. Quiero decir, a mí me gusta mucho ver al Atleti de Bilbao y si juega contra un equipo israelí, pues igual tengo que quedarme sin verle. Claro, el Maccabi contra no sé qué equipo, Mayumana, que me puede gustar mucho, pues no ir a verle. O sea, quiero decir, eso son cosas que empiezan a crear un estado social que igual hace que los políticos, luego también depende de qué políticos y de qué políticos no, pero que los políticos tomen carta en el asunto, haya decisiones de municipios, etcétera, etcétera, tal, tal, y eso se va tejiendo. Y eso es una cosa que podemos hacer cada uno de nosotros, ya digo, no solo intentar organizar, sino acudir a aquello que otros organicen. O sea, porque claro, yo creo que tenemos que ir más allá de una charla súper buena, súper explicativa, pero que también tenemos que coger un compromiso atendiendo a cuál es la realidad. La realidad es que Palestina es hoy en día, pues eso, lo que podía ser, no sé, el gueto de no sé qué, o el campo de concentración de Auschwitz, o no sé qué, pero a lo bruto, mucho.
Es que los más media تكلم عربي بوتو سي انا ما نعرف من مدى وسائل الاعلام تتكلم على معاناه الفلسطينيين في مخيمات يرموك في نواحي دمشق واجتماع اليوم والامس بغرناطه هل هذا يعد في حد ذاته شيئا يرمز لشيء وانا متفائل لكن متشائم كيف ستكون مستقبل غزه في ظل سيسي كرئيس لمصر
Bai, se está cago itzulpen hori, o sea, que euskera eta gaztelera dago baina.
Bueno, ha preguntado acerca lo ha entendido él, ¿no? Ha llegado él. Ha preguntado acerca de la situación que viven los 300.000 refugiados palestinos en el campo de refugiados de Al-Yarmouk, cerca de Damasco. Luego de algo que pasó en Granada o en el sur, que no sé qué es lo que ha pasado ahí. Y luego, además, preguntó cuál es la opinión del señor Sorani acerca de lo que puede vivir Gaza teniendo a el general Sisi como el primer personaje fuerte en el actual Egipto. Es decir, cuál es el reflejo de la presencia de los militares egipcios en el gobierno a Gaza.
just begin with the last question and go then. About Palestinian refugees in Syria. By the way, Australia offered to take 300,000 to Australia completely. I mean, to take them. And if the Palestinian has more, they are most welcome. And they don't want to go. I mean, Palestinians, with the shelling, with the bombing, with the killing, they don't want to go. That's what I mean when we are talking about the stones of the valley. I mean, Palestinians are there, and no power on earth will take them from there. They are for the third consecutive generation, and they are not weak. They are victims, but they are not weak, and they will survive, don't worry. But this brought again, once and again, the issue of the Palestinian refugees. And as I said, when UNRWA was established in 1953, it wasn't established for Palestinian refugees by PLO or by the Arabs. It was established by the international community, who thought there is unjust, unfair, criminal treatment has been against them, and they have the right to return, as it has been explicitly stated in Resolution 191 of the Security Council. Anyway, it is very unfortunate, and they are misused, especially by the Islamist groups, because in the very beginning, Palestine and Palestinians were totally avoid, but to trigger a new level of sensitivity, Palestinians were targeted in totally illegitimate way. And I hope things now, I mean, much calmer. In these few days, it is much, much calmer than it used to be, for example, a month ago and before. The problem of refugees, as it has been in Lebanon, it will be in Syria, it will be in Jordan, and there is one solution for these Palestinian refugees, to go back, to have the right of return, and to go to their own country as any normal human being. Number two, it's about Egypt and the Sisi. Egypt, it's not our fate. I mean, Palestine, Gaza, West Bank, including Jerusalem. That's the state, I mean, we want to have. But we are disconnected from the West Bank and Jerusalem. We cannot, I haven't been there 15 years. It seems you missed, I mean, the first part of the lecture. And Gaza airport has been razed and destroyed, so nobody, I mean, can use the fly. And the sea is under blockade. So we have occupation, and the occupation, this criminal occupation, supported not only by US, but by the quartet, I mean, in doing this blockade in Gaza. And that's the really problem, because the occupation is responsible legally on the occupied territories. Responsible on the welfare of the Palestinian civilians in the occupied territories. And that's why we shouldn't derail the discussion. Egypt is not responsible on Gaza. They have no legal responsibility on Gaza. It's the Israeli belligerent occupation who are responsible on that. In Israel, in Egypt, there is internal massive problem, and I think this will last for years. I don't want to be dragged into it, but in simple words, we have in Sinai very, very serious security problem. And you go to Sinai, it's almost, you feel you are in a state of war. Poppy-trapped cars, which never, ever violence was introduced in the history of Egypt. Now it is part of the daily life there, massive arrest happening there, sometimes, you know, lack of respect, I mean, of law, the confusion about whether we are having coup d'etat or not, Rab and what had happened there. So there is massive problem. I'm personally very, very worried about Egypt and its human rights record and where it's going. I don't know whether situation will deteriorate more, but likely it's going to deteriorate more at the foreseeable future. The military very firm in their line, and they think the train departed and they will continue all the way along. They want to eat, as we say, the whole pig, not part of it, but all of it. And they are going in a very constituent way in this regard. And the Muslim Brotherhoods decided to go in full confrontation, including using real violence, I mean, against the system. And that's what's happening. So the title, Can We Resolve Politically a Problem Through Security Recipe? It's ABC for politicians. They know political problem cannot be resolved through security measures. It can be resolved only through political measures. And that's what needed in Egypt, to sit, talk, recognize the other, and conclude political solution for this deep crisis in Egypt. Otherwise, Egypt going to hell. Now, this inflicted on Gaza, but I would say there is some stupid behavior happened by Hamas government, not government, but by the people inside Gaza of Hamas, which provocated quite a lot. I mean, the Egyptians at some stage. I mean, they still call the people there. It is coup d'etat. And that's make them, I mean, very agitated and angry. And you would see in the prayers of Friday or at the local radio stations or in the Hamas TV, you know, supporting Morsi and the Muslim Brotherhoods against that. And that's agitate, in a way, I mean, the regime again. For us as a Palestinian, I don't think we should by any level involve in the internal Egyptian thing. Egypt, it's like our two lungs for Gaza. If we lose it, irrelevant whether you like the politics or not, but there is something they call it the rudeness of geopolitique. But you cannot think. You cannot. If you go and confront Egypt, Toro style, you are loser. I mean, for us, 365 square kilometers, disconnected, 2 million people, you are hitting your head to the wall. But not ordinary well, it's not wood. It's real rock. It's suicidal. We don't have the luxury even to think of that. The young lady, but she, it's very interesting. But we are trying our best to make what we call it legal documentation for the war crimes, the crimes against humanity perpetrated by the occupation. And we, I think, have very unique experience, and we have the professionalism, the independence, and the credibility. It's not only reports, I mean compiled. And we make sure that we report about really what's going on and to make it in the public domain and people know about it, among others, politicians, you know, who should be aware about what's going on there. And that's why we try to be very interactive with solidarity groups across the globe. And we always, I mean, we feel proud, part of their agenda. They take our material, they disseminate it, many of them translate it. We produce our material in Arabic and English, but I can assure you it's translated to Spanish, and it's all over Spain and Latin America. I mean, by friends and colleagues who do that voluntarily. Some do that, you know, in Swedish, and they will disseminate it all over. In French, all our material go in French. There is a group who's doing that. Last strange request I received from China. I mean, they said, we want to translate, I mean, the reports and disseminate it, I mean. So we want to make sure nobody can claim we don't know as much as we can. We don't have mass media, very unfortunately, but I can assure you, for example, PCHR has almost 60,000 addresses. And these addresses, one address of them, for example, goes to the French civil society network, which means like 2,000 organizations. That's super fantastic. That's our possibility and capacity. We try, of course, to address EU. We try to address relevant bodies, I mean, as much as we can. And as I said in the morning, the Israelis hold accountable the Pope. They said to him, you knew about the Holocaust, and you kept silent. You didn't say anything. We want to make sure everybody at least know about really what's going on. And that's when I'm telling you, I mean, try to break the conspiracy of silence about what's going on at that part of the world. So hopefully, I mean, this message being conveyed, and I'm sure, I mean, our colleagues, friends, and comrades are doing fantastic work, I mean, in this regard. That's how we educate people about what's going on. Activities, that's why it's very important, visits by solidarity groups, I mean, to Palestine. Because when they come, when they learn about the situation, they are our messengers. I mean, not needed, I mean, to be across the globe to convey this, but they also can talk about that. I don't know whether you are a student or not, but we have a program at PCHR for internships, and we receive especially people who are in law, political science, social studies, to come stay with us for a period between 3 months to 1 year. And they usually come, help us in the work. Meanwhile, they are educated about the situation, and we have super fantastic networks over the course of years in Italy, in Ireland, in US, in Sweden, in Spain, in the Basque. Your people come and get that, and this is another way, I mean, how to convey also the message.